So we launched Hubble in 1990. It was actually a pretty old space telescope, considering that we're still, you know, we've gotten a lot of images from it even recently.
Yeah.
But this is probably the telescope you guys are most familiar with. You had mentioned something about it. So Hubble operates in the visible light spectrum. And there is a very wide spectrum for light to operate in, right? Visible light is the light that humans can see. It's the color spectrum.
It's a sliver of the entire electromagnetic spectrum.
A very small sliver.
I didn't know that. I kind of assumed, because I always see those images from like deep space, like a look at a nebula or something. Mm-hmm. And they always like preface it by saying, this isn't exactly the picture. Mm-hmm. This is a rendering, a representation of the data from the telescope. Mm-hmm. So like they're capturing a lot of information, and if you were to just look at the nebula, it wouldn't look like that amazing, like colorful cloud of stars. It would be pretty rough on your eye. So they adjust it. Yeah. I kind of assumed they were getting like infrared and all x-rays and all sorts of other stuff, but that I did not know that.
It's sort of like tone mapping, right? It's
exactly.
Like you say it doesn't look that way, and it's like, well, we can only perceive violet through, you know, deep red,
right?
But actually, they can do this thing. It's like tone mapping where they take specific frequencies of that frequency, and then they map that to different colors. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, Hubble operates in the visible light spectrum, but it's a super, super small part of the entire electromagnetic system, of the entire electromagnetic spectrum. So it can only see a certain distance into space or through a certain amount of time.
This is now we're getting into like nerdy, like math structure. Basically, the universe is expanding, therefore light that is over a certain age takes longer to reach us because it's coming from further away. So if it's a faster, I'm gonna mess it up. I don't know exactly how to explain it, but basically you can only see so far into the past if you can only see so much of the different wavelengths. So if you can see x-rays, you can see more parts of the universe than if you can't see x-rays, basically. But that's about as deep as I could go on that.
Yeah. So basically light travels at a static speed, right? Still extremely fast.
In a vacuum, it's always the same speed.
Yeah,
in space
it can go through,
Yeah.
It can go through materials and change speed, sort of. But so space is so big that we actually measure distance in light years. And it's a little bit confusing because you would think years is time. Turns out space and time are kind of the same thing. Right.
Yeah. A light year is the amount of distance that a ray of light would travel in a year at the speed of light.
Right.
So the speed of light is constant. So a light year is an incredibly long distance.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. So on Earth, that speed is so fast that it doesn't really matter.
This is at like cosmic scales, not like us versus Mars.
That's Paul Geithner. He's a deputy project manager, technical at NASA.
I saw recently that Earth is 7 light minutes from the sun.
Actually 8, but close enough.
So it takes light 7 minutes to get from the Earth to the sun. So a light year is an absurdly far distance. Like light goes a really long way in a year.
Yeah.
So okay.
Yeah, so if like the sun just randomly turned off or burned out, we wouldn't know for 7 minutes.
Exactly.
We would still feel the heat. We'd still feel the energy. We'd still see.
I saw a Vsauce video about that. That was a crazy, you know, gravity travels at the speed of light. That was another thing. We'd orbit where the sun used to be for 7 more minutes. Anyway, that's a little off topic. That's a little off topic, but okay, here we are.
Yeah, okay. So Hubble, because it only exists in the visible light spectrum and it's made to see things that are, you know, the visible light that's getting to us, can only see a certain distance because the light that is hitting us is still in the visible light spectrum, right? So, but what if you want to see further in time, right? What if you want to see closer to like the Big Bang to understand the origins of the universe, how things were originally developed, that kind of stuff, right? To do that, you have to look at infrared light. So on the electromagnetic spectrum, you've got ultraviolet light, and then you've got visible light, and then you've got infrared light. Those two things pad the visible spectrum, right?
Yeah.
But the universe is expanding, as you alluded to earlier, and that causes something called redshift. Do you guys know what redshift is?
Oh, if this was a pop quiz, I would not be getting this right, but it's kind of,
I wouldn't even be trying to answer.
Yeah, I don't want to butcher it because I'm sure you'll tell me exactly what it is, but it's kind of like the Doppler effect, but for light. Is that?
Yeah, that's pretty accurate.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, so you know what the Doppler effect is?
When something gets closer to you, it's sort of compressing the wavelength because it's it'll sound differently because it's approaching you and when it's leaving you mm-hmm. versus if it was just stationary right next to you. So mm-hmm. when you hear a train pass by, it sounds like it changes pitch
right.
because the frequency is perceived differently when it's relatively changing position to you.
Yeah, yeah.
I can like only ever imagine the police siren going past picture of it and trying to explain it in words is very hard.
It's hard to say with words.
It's a relativity thing, and relativity is very hard to comprehend. It takes a while to sort of understand it.
Yeah.
And it took me a long time to understand redshift, like 3 weeks. Okay, so this is definitely a little bit of an oversimplification, but redshift is, it's sort of like the Doppler effect, but for light, right? But because light moves so fast that we don't see redshift in everyday life. Like, if a blue light is moving away from us, it doesn't turn red. But over thousands of light years, there is a perceived change in the frequency of that light. It's not actually changing frequency, because light doesn't actually lose energy as it moves. But because of relativity, we perceive it differently. Very hard to like understand.
I'm trying to put the puzzle pieces together in my head with redshift and being able to see further in the universe.
Yeah.
Sounds like if the universe is expanding, then the most precious information in the universe is traveling away from us. And so all of that light information or electromagnetic information is being shifted towards infrared.
Mm-hmm.
And so the Hubble can't see that stuff, but something that could see frequency wavelengths like infrared could see that stuff. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so you can sort of think of redshift as like a loaf of raisin bread. This is the analogy that Paul made with me.
Okay, I'm picturing raisin bread.
So you've got the loaf, and then you have the raisins in the bread, right?
But you haven't put it in the oven yet, right? And you've got dough, and it's got raisins in it, and all those raisins are kind of close together. And then you throw it in the pan, and you stick it in the oven, and the dough rises, right? So the dough is like space, so it's expanding, and it's expanding. All of it's expanding.
As the bread expands, the raisins are also expanding away from each other.
Right.
That's like stars and planets in our universe, right? So the raisins are effectively the stars. The stars are emitting light, but because they are expanding away from each other at like an exponential rate, because it moves faster away from each other as the fabric expands.
That's the key. The universe is expanding, but it's also accelerating in its expansion.
Yes.
That was hard for my brain to wrap around.
Right.
But again, another Neil deGrasse Tyson quote.
This dark energy in the future will render the universe so large, having accelerated so significantly that all the galaxies of the night sky will have accelerated beyond our horizon.
What?
And all the galaxies are the source of our knowledge of cosmology, of the Big Bang. Everything we know about the history of the universe comes to us from these galaxies. If they accelerate beyond our horizon, the next generation of cosmic explorers will only have the stars of the Milky Way to think about.
One by one, the stars in the night sky will disappear because they're all moving away from us. And eventually it will be completely blank and we will have no access to the information from the beginnings of the universe because it would have moved away so fast that we can't see it anymore.
Yeah.
And that was like,
that's also
deep.
Sort of part of the theory of like the inevitable heat death of the universe.
Yeah.
Is that like everything will just keep moving away to so where far. They can't interact anymore. And then there is no energy. And then the universe is dead. Hmm. The reason that it's accelerating is in its expansion is because you can see this graph right here.
Hmm.
That's the Big Bang. Stars and stuff are being pulled by some unknown force that we don't understand yet. And so they think that there is like, that's dark matter that is pulling mm-hmm. these stars and these planets away from each other, but it's making them accelerate.
Yeah.
Right? So, okay, back to the raisin bread.
But you haven't put it in the oven yet.
So when things are accelerating away from each other, you're getting the Doppler effect, the red shift, but from the backside, right? Instead of coming towards each other and the frequency goes higher, they're going mm-hmm. away from each other and the frequency is going lower. So if something is emitted in ultraviolet and visible light, by the time it gets to you because they're expanding away from each other, it ends up in something like the infrared spectrum.
Okay.
Right? So then we had to build a telescope that could actually take in infrared light.
Sounds like this was the major next generation type thing for James Webb Space Telescope.
Yeah, so that's kind of the interesting thing, right? Is that we've actually had telescopes in pretty much every spectrum already. Mm-hmm. We already had a telescope in the infrared spectrum too. It was called Spitzer. but it just didn't have nearly as high resolution cameras, and it didn't have like all this tech that JWST has. So it could see like, you know, some stuff, but it couldn't really get the information that we're trying to get from JWST.
It's like a mid-range. We're looking for the ultra.
With the flagship.
We're looking for the flagship infrared telescope.
Right.
Yeah.
It wasn't even remotely as advanced.
Yeah.
So, but basically we had telescopes in all the different ranges from like X-ray to visible to infrared.
It was such a smart move in the 1980s to plan what we call the Great Observatories.
This is Jonathan McDowell. He's an astronomer at the Center for Astrophysics, Harvard and Smithsonian.
Which was not let's build Hubble, but let's have a portfolio of telescopes. And with that array of telescopes combined with ground-based, we could cover the whole spectrum and get the whole story. And that was scientifically gangbusters. It was really successful.
Because we wanted to confirm science, right? If we're seeing something in a specific spectrum of the electromagnetic spectrum, if we can confirm that in every other spectrum, then we basically know it must be true, at least in our version of physics, right? In our version of the universe. But yeah, Spitzer was old tech, and it was way smaller than JWST too. With telescopes, bigger is better, pretty much always.
Yeah, this is one I keep seeing. You know, I always wonder, like, well, why don't you just use like better sensors that are more sensitive, blah blah. But with space, you can't really overcome the need for physics. Mm-hmm. Like, you need a massive telescope to see further and see more.
Right.
And like down here on Earth, the difference between here and taking a picture of across the street or taking a picture of down the block is like, oh, go from a 50 millimeter lens to an 800 millimeter lens. Mm-hmm. But to see from here to the beginnings of the universe, like, you can't overcome the need for, you just need a huge telescope. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So I was very impressed with the physics and the precision needed to create like an extremely smooth surface for the mirrors and an extremely large amount of, I'm sure you'll explain this,
but
that's the type of stuff that's like straight up engineering prowess, which is exciting.
Yeah, the JWST is massive, 22 over. Meters by 12 meters.
Okay, 22 meters, so 60 feet, cool.
Okay.
That's pretty big. Yeah.
Also, effectively, if you want to capture more light, you have to have a bigger telescope, especially in the infrared spectrum. Because if you think about the way that light and energy are sort of the same thing, you get burned by ultraviolet light, right? And the reason is because it has a really high energy, because it has a really high frequency.
You can think of it as like a light bucket. Like if you put a little shot glass out in the yard and it's raining, and you put a kiddie pool out in the yard when it's raining, well, they'll each collect half an inch of rain if it rains half an inch. But which one has more water if you pour it out? The little shot glass has, you know, less than an ounce in it. The kiddie pool, it's a half inch deep, but, you know, in each of those raindrops, you can say is photons of light. So that kiddie pool, while it's a half inch deep, the kiddie pool is like 6 feet in diameter, and you pour the water out and you can fill like a Home Depot bucket.
Yeah. So just make it as big as possible to get the best resolution that you can.
It's a good visual.
Thanks for watching this clip. If you want to learn more about people named James or webs that are either made by spiders or telescopes, make sure that you watch the entire episode on the Waveform podcast channel, and make sure that you also subscribe to the Clips channel so you never miss a clip like this. Was that okay?